Hey, welcome back for our second devlog. It's been a while since we released our first one, and we wanted to just show you a bit about the studio, tell you about our roles moving forward, and today we wanted to show you everything we've been up to in the last few months. So I found it quite challenging to make this video as we covered so much in the last few months and I need to break it down to about 5 minutes. So we're gonna give this a shot and we'll see where it goes. So first off, I needed to create more refined versions of the assets to go into our train yard. So I modeled some basic placeholders for a few carts and a train head. I had to duplicate them enough just to populate the area a little bit, and this took way longer than I thought it was going to. Remember this placeholder for the mountain tunnel I said I was going to do? Well, I ended up modeling, sculpting, and texturing the entire asset, just as a way of practicing and refining my skills a little bit in sculpting, as it's a completely new type of art form to me. Now, I kept these pieces separate as I wanted to create modular mountain pieces that I can reuse later on in the game. It was around this time that I realized I kind of wanted to tackle the lighting of the world, mostly because it had really bugged me that I was tiptoeing around just getting to it. It took me a while to figure out, but I was able to create a nighttime scene that fit the dark, moody atmosphere that our game is going for. Now, directly after the train yard portion of the level, I moved to creating a concept design of the water docking area. Now, I needed the train to come out the other end of the mountain, as you remember from before. So what I did is I ended up just creating a bridge that I wanted the train to move on. This bridge also has a purpose to being a platform mechanic later on for the game, as kind of like a tutorial. I then moved on to creating a few basic assets that are just meant to be background filler for the time being. Now for the fun part, character modeling. Now, just to be clear, this is not anywhere in my area of expertise. When I started out with the base mesh, I got about this far. It looks like horseshit, I know. So instead of wasting my precious time on creating a base mesh that's been recreated over a million times, I decided instead just to download one and then edit it as is. And it didn't come out too bad. I actually really like what I did. Now, we are going for kind of like a stylized low poly feel. So for example, the hair just kind of adds on that little bit of extra stylized low poly that I'm going for. I then moved on to rigging in Blender, and I don't know what to tell you. I think I'm just gonna stick to Mixamo for now. We'll figure out the animation stuff maybe in another period. So beyond that, I still had a lot of issues with animations. Importing them from Mixamo into Blender, yeah, you can see for yourself, it's not great. I don't even know what's going on, to be honest with you. Like, what is even happening here? But I was eventually able to figure it out, and I got Lucy doing literally the most basic function ever. Running. Yes, I spent a month figuring out how to make my character run. That's game dev for you, I guess. Okay, let's move on to something else before I lose it.
Simulations.
Now, I got this add-on from another creator. I'll leave the link in the description if you want to take a look, but it's called Simply Cloth Pro. It's amazing. I'd highly recommend it if you want to just simplify your life in terms of creating clothing for your characters and you can't afford marvelous designer. Now, moving away from character design, I wanted to do something simple like creating background mountains in Blender that can be procedurally generated. Now, keep in mind, everything in this demo is meant to also be producing some sort of a tutorial. So I have this warehouse that I've designed that will kind of introduce the stealth mechanics of our game. I'm really excited to show this part of the game off, but it will also take a lot of work. I also played around with procedurally destructible meshes. I'm not too sure if this is the right way to do it. I might also look into using the chaos system, which I think will be better than animating it, well, simulating it in Blender and then moving it over. I'm still trying to figure out what's the best method to go about, but this is as far as I got. Next, I worked on what I think would be one of the coolest levels of the game, and it's what I'm excited to show the most of. Lucy will eventually run into a bunker, and when she runs in there, we're gonna try and create an atmosphere that's very spooky and dark and cold. It's meant to give World War II feel vibes to it, but also to introduce other elements that I don't really want to show off right now. Don't worry, it will make sense in the narrative as we move along. Now, I used a lot of really great reference images for how I wanted to design this section of the game, and you know, as a designer, I'm kind of learning reference images are basically key to everything you're doing. A lot of basic gameplay mechanics will be learned and done here in this part of the game. including a few surprises along the way that I'm, again, really excited to show off. And that's it for me. It's been really fun kind of just showing off everything we've been doing in the last 3 months, at least on my end. Ricardo and Delina will be showing you soon at least what they've been working on, and thanks for watching, guys.
All right, so Ricardo here with all the programming updates with play mechanics and game mechanics. An essential gameplay mechanic for most 2.5D side-scroller types of games like Inside or Little Nightmares is the ability to mantle or climb ledges, walls, boxes, all of that type of stuff. So I figured, you know, why not just start with a mantling system? So after a little bit of searching around, I came across Matt Asplund's tutorial. Great tutorial, didn't have any free assets, so I'd used a combination of Matt Asplund and Andrew Elliott game design. And after some simple code, nothing too complex, it doesn't work. a little bit of digging around, saw that it was root motion, enabled it, everything's good, and the end result is what we need for now. It's a good learning experience, but I may replace it with a more complex system later down the line. Again, just needed to touch up on some blueprints. But as you can see, everything really works. Well, kind of almost really works. Future Ricardo will deal with that. So now that I'm a pro at blueprints, it's time to implement one of the most important mechanics in our game, I guess, which is the throwing system. It will be used to, like, for stealth or distracting, kind of like pacifist gameplay. So obviously we need something to throw, and a sphere as a rock works pretty good for me. We need to raycast the curve and make sure that the rock can be thrown in the target location, and added a mesh to the fragments to visualize this line trace. However, you can see that it doesn't quite follow the cursor, so I need to try and fix that. Essentially, I need to figure out the right velocity to provide given a start and an end location. This proved to be a lot more difficult than I first expected, and ended up with very, very interesting results. So after hours of searching around, turns out Unreal Engine just has a function to suggest the custom arc velocity that we need. Cool, I'll just get rid of everything, all the math and everything we did, and it just happens to work. We can then reuse our mantling animations, cause I could not be bothered to put in a throwing animation right away. Alright, so obviously needed a break from that system, so I figured, hey, may as well learn Niagara, right? How bad can it be? Just like, got snow falling right away, just made the velocity aligned and added collision. Bouncing rain, that's some progress. Made the collision kill the particles, now we've got actual rain, okay, cool. We added 2D texture for the raindrop, and now there's like raindrops. Then for the lightning, we can kind of just like fake that with a 2D plane and a lightning texture. Control the emission through a material, you know, make it brighter, darker, cool. Add a timeline to that, and there's kind of lightning and rain. Great, and so as a reward for getting the weather system working, we're gonna torture ourselves with finishing the throwing system. Cool. So we're calling the throwing system the sound visualization system, because when a rock hits the ground, we want to visualize the area of sound and everything it impacts. So first, we're going to give the system a location and spawn the ball. We're going to then make this ball very small and play around with some events to grow it over time. And it's pretty easy to do, except it does not stop growing. So we will add a timeline and kill it once the time limit has reached. And just like that, we can spawn these balls that grow to a max size over a set period of time. Next thing to do is play around with some materials, apply it to this ball. We can change some intensity values to get the effect we want. And it looks perfect. Then we can use our actual prototyping models and some throwing animations, some actual throwing animations, and we've got a working throwing system. So what's the next steps? I guess I really want to tackle some AI, you know, get some AI wandering around, some chase sequences or just patrolling sequences, get the rock interacting with them or get them interacting with the sound, and work more on the sound visualization system. There's some really cool effects that I want to play around with, like making the weather react with in-game sounds or making shadows react with in-game sounds. So that's going to be all experimental. And yeah, that's the current updates with the player mechanics and game mechanics. So there's a lot more to implement, a lot more, but we're getting there. So that's all from me. I'll check you on the next one.
Hello everyone, we're back with another video. It's been a little bit since our last one, but I'm excited to show you what I've been up to since then. For those of you who don't know, my name is Delina. I am the lead art and audio designer here at the studio. During the winter, I also spent a lot of time working on a grant application to help us out with some of our production costs. We did end up getting the grant, which is super exciting, and it helped us with some of our equipment costs just for the first stage of the game's development. Okay, so I'll be showing you a few things today. Part of my composition process, part of my sound design process, some character concept art, and a little tutorial on how I create sound cues in order to be used for later animations for our characters in Unreal Engine 5. Let's start with the music. I've been composing cues for the opening world. We wanted the world to feel eerie and a little unnerving and kind of spooky, so I tried to emulate those emotions in the music itself. I've actually only used Spitfire Audio Labs libraries for this sound cue. If you haven't heard of them before, I'd highly recommend checking them out. I wanted the vibe to be a little unfamiliar and dissonant and more textural, so I've chosen not to use typical instruments like strings or horns in this cue. Here's a quick listen. I've also been working on musical themes for our creature character. I'm using the BBC Symphony Orchestra library, also from Spitfire Audio, along with some native instruments, contact percussion, and some more Labs libraries as well. So there are some more familiar sounds in there, but hopefully it's still sounding a little ominous. Here's another peek in that. Let's move on to some sound effects sourcing and design. So, as I mentioned in our last video, we are wanting to have as many sound effects as possible be sounds that we originally sourced, not just all ones we got off the internet. There's absolutely nothing wrong with getting sounds off the internet and going that route, but since we had the capacity to craft a lot of those sounds ourselves, we wanted to use that opportunity to use those skills and add another unique element to the game. A lot of the things I'm using to create a lot of these sounds are things I already have in my house, or is just my voice. I'm using things like kitchen utensils, glassware, pots and pans, sand, water sounds from different sinks in my house. There's a bunch of things. The main thing I know though is the better the raw organic sound that you're getting, the better it's all gonna sound once you enhance and modify and mix and stuff, all of that together. That ending sound is going to be a lot better if your original sound is high quality first. Here are some of the sounds I've been working on for various things around the game world. Plugin I use in this work that I definitely have to mention is Brucey from Club Grant. This is a plugin that reduces the amount of noise that's being recorded in the background of your sound, whether it's from an object or an instrument, and it leaves your sound a lot more clear and crisp without any background interference. This is perfect for me because I often record in places that aren't soundproof well or at all. Just around my house, and it just really helps me out. Earlier in January, we contracted an artist to come up with some of the early concept designs that we could use to base our character models off of and visualize in game. We wanted you guys to be able to see kind of where we're headed with their designs. And so here's a look at our main character, Lucy, and our secondary character, Dagon. I think this concept art turned out super cool. The last thing I wanted to show you today is how to create a sound cue in Unreal Engine that you can then use later on for adding to your animation processes. First, open your content drawer and right click, select sounds, and then select either sound cue or meta sound source. Keep in mind that meta sound source is only available in Unreal Engine 5, but you can use sound cues with any version. Open up your sound cue and start bringing in your wave files. If you're in meta sounds, bring in a wave player first. If you wanted your sounds to play randomly, bring in a random node and connect it to each wave file. If you want your sounds to play together, bring in a mixer node and a modulation node. If you want your sounds to play on loop, you can either bring in a looping node or set the audio file to loop individually. Connect all these to your output. In MetaSounds, you have the option of mono or stereo. And there you go, you have a super quick, easy group of sounds that you can use anywhere in your Unreal Engine world. I will try and add another footstep tutorial on how I'm implementing these into my animations. That's all for me today. Thanks so much for watching. If you want to see more consistent content, follow our social media accounts. We're always posting on there, especially our TikTok and Instagram. We really appreciate all of you who are already following along with us on our journey to create our first game, and we'll be back with another devlog soon. Bye.